Well, thank you very much, Professor Domda. Much too kind, the introduction. So I'll try to give an overview of what we can do by looking at the protein level with mass spectrometry in this context and just give you a flavor. And there's many more things you can do, but I hope this will give you a flavor. So let's see to get the pen. Yeah, so I should say I'm in two places, and we also bring in some expertise and some knowledge from Copenhagen as well, also from the studies, as you will see. So what we do is, I won't go into a lot of details here, but what we do is take our samples and then make them amenable to proteomics. So our kind of proteomics is mass spec-based proteomics. So here is mass spectrometer, another mass spectrometer. So we analyze our samples here from study participants, for instance, and then we do omic analysis and come to some conclusions about biomarkers, about mechanisms. So, and we like to do it automated and as deep and fast as we can. So just to give you a flavor of what I generally can do with this technology, not even in the context of a clinical study. So this is where we recently took proteomes, or the proteins of a lot of different organisms, 100 different organisms across the kingdoms of life. And then we used the latest and greatest technology, for instance, these chip columns here. And then we, by this, actually doubled the number of proteins with experimental evidence for them that were known to that time. So this just gives you a flavor of what you can do with this technology, which is still much behind genomics, but it's catching up and it has some advantages. So we do a lot of bioinformatics and software development, which we also make accessible to the DigiMed context. So, and here it's of particular relevance is this clinical knowledge graph. So what we do here is that we integrate all the data that we actually generate ourselves, but then normally you would be stuck here for googling for weeks and months to generate hypotheses, and you may miss information. But when we look at what's happened in the internet at large, like at Google, it's actually amazingly good with just a few words. It sort of guesses magically what you were trying to find, and it shows you. So we are taking the same underlying technology, and that is called a knowledge graph, to put all the data in that's already known, or the literature, for instance. So this is our data model, what that goes into this software, into this knowledge graph, and then we have the databases that are available on the internet, like UniProt and so on and so on, drug databases. So that all goes in as a background. And then we use an open source database as the underlying resource, Neo4j, and put it all together with the relationships, and this forms a gigantic graph. So you can see how gigantic. So these were at the time 16 million of these points, nodes, and more than 110 million connections between them. So this is also how Facebook works underneath, and many other things work that you know about. And then you can query it for the questions you might have, or you get associations automatically. So this is already on GitHub, and these are the people. Alberto Santos is driving it in Copenhagen, and he's also in Oxford. Yeah, so people can use it, and we are making that available to DigiMed as well. So then next thing is that we can analyze plasma proteomes or any body fluid, and we laid out the promises and pitfalls of this approach here in a review with Professor Teubser and Holt. But here in the Klinikum Großhadern, there's 9 million lab tests per year, and most of them actually involve proteins. So it's just done with ELISA tests and such like, but they do involve proteins. So if we can measure them all at once, it would be very good. So that's what we're trying to do. Then here is our workflow that we've developed over the last year. So just need a finger prick of blood. it's getting automatically processed and then analyzed quite rapidly. And then you get the plasma proteome profile, so the proteins in your blood to a certain depth, and that can tell you about your risk for heart disease or other diseases. And this was spearheaded by Dr. Philip Geyer and also Sophia Dorlis in the effort, and you'll actually hear from her tomorrow. So they're both at a startup company here now in Munich, which is also important. So here's an example that we've already done in Copenhagen, and this is the first time where we can actually look at a very serious and common disorder, that's liver disease, and actually outperform for the first time the existing tests that have been around for decades. So it's serious because more than a billion of the world population actually have at least a fatty liver, and then it can go on a certain percentage to fibrosis and cirrhosis and cancer of the liver, and you want to detect this early here or here where it's still reversible. So not all, but a certain number of people would actually change their ways and their drugs in the pipeline that they could still be reverting in this direction. But there are no good tests, especially for the early detection. So this is a project that Lily, who is now graduating in Copenhagen, she spearheaded together with Philip also in the beginning. And we have done a number of studies, and the latest one is with about 600 people here in alcoholic liver disease. So you can get liver disease for a number of different reasons, and alcohol is one. And then out of this cohort, we're trying to see whether we can find new biomarkers and how we can predict the development of fibrosis. And I don't have time to go into this, but we actually also have tissue samples from a number of these people and the plasma. So this actually enables us to say something builds up in the liver first, and then you can see it in the plasma, or it could be also the converse, it's missing in the liver and you see it up in the plasma, or the other way around. So we can see these markers, and we can see them as a pseudo time course here over the fibrotic stages. So and we've done a number of studies also together with the Helmholtz Center here in Munich, and we actually indeed find the same new biomarkers also in mouse models. And this is also, just want to rush over this, but this is the usual ROC curve for machine learning. So now we can actually predict fibrosis better than on par on or better than the existing tests, which are either classical liver enzymes or they are based on ultrasound to measure the stiffness of the liver. So that's very promising and very good. And this is also a thing that we came across. I didn't think it would infect me so much, but it does. And this is what we already heard about in the previous talk, that we actually running square into the GDPR issues, and we've actually now ourselves done some research in this, and how can we, you know, is the plasma proteome actually, should it be regulated similarly to the genome? Because we can, we've just published this, that you could actually be identified in certain circumstances by the plasma proteome. And you know, how should we handle this? And there's two papers if you're interested. And this is actually also interesting because it's a family thing here with Sebastian, who's bioethicist at Oxford. So now I'm coming to tissue, and we've all seen the revolution in the last few years where bulk measurements were actually replaced by single cell measurement with great success in transcriptomics and other omics measurements. And the usual picture that you see, that in one case you would get a smoothie here like this, and I mean like this here. But if you really want to know what's happening biologically, it would be very advantageous if you knew what was going on in the different cell types. So this was just fantasy for proteomics for until very recently, but not anymore. And again, this is here spearheaded single cell proteomics in our lab by Andreas Bohner. Other labs are also working on this. So we use this technology where we need to handle this one cell very carefully not to lose it, and then liquid chromatography and particular kind of ultra-sensitive mass spectrometry. So in particular, this involves a very low flow chromatography by a Danish startup that I'm actually involved in. It's called Evosep. And I don't want to go into the technical details, but basically you handle the one cell here or here very coordinately and very carefully in a 20 nanometer volume. Then you eject into this, so it comes to be in this preformed gradient, which you can then push out to the mass spectrometer in a very controlled fashion at a very low flow rate, increasing in this part the sensitivity about tenfold. And then there's another part on the mass spectrometer, which gives us another factor of 5 to 10. So if we just dilute down our standards here, this is like 1.5 years ago, we could get over 3,000 proteins if we have 5 nanogram, and still over 1,000 when we have 1 nanogram. So how much is that? That corresponds to 4 HeLa cells. And now, since very recently, with a new instrument that is not on the market, so it may never be on the market, but that's the new development. You can see here that when we fax sort individual cells, so for instance, 0 cells in the well here, then we also don't get any proteins. But if we fax sort one cell individually, we get about 1,000 proteins here, and so on as we go up to 8 cells, and something went wrong here. So that is, I think, quite significant. And the latest and greatest is here. So we can we can now, in the best case, go up to 2,000 proteins in a single cell. And this is not just any single cell, but these are cells cycle stages where we've arrested the cells in different parts of the cell cycle, and we do see the cell cycle markers as well. So, and then this is quantification. So if we have bulk material quantified against bulk material, we get a nice diagonal here, as we should. Then E8 cells is still quantitatively quite accurately, but I find this quite amazing. So if you have only one cell, so this is one cell, the proteome, quantified against another one cell proteome, and this is also a pretty good diagonal. So this has many also conceptual implications, because what it means is that, so for sure we're still limited by the technology, but what we can already see is that every single cell has a stable proteome that is maintained qualitatively and quantitatively. And also what we see is that single cells have a shared core proteome. So for instance, in the cell cycle, largely the proteins are shared, but then the ones that participate in the cell cycle, they are different. And this is also maybe not as trivial as it sounds, because this is not the case at the transcriptome level. And this is a comparison to two different ways of doing single cell transcriptomics. So DropSeq or 10x genomics would be the same here, or SmartSeq, it's a little bit better. But if you see the variation here, it's much, much lower at the protein level. And this makes biological sense, because you only have to make every once in a while a new transcript. But the protein should be in each single cell very well regulated, otherwise the cell doesn't function. But we believe this will help us a lot in reading out the functional state of the single cell as we do single cell proteomics. So this is a collaborative work with Fabian Theiss's group at Helmholtz and the Bruker company. And it's already available as a preprint at BioArchive if you're interested. Now coming to the tissue level, and this is the technology spearheaded in Copenhagen and by Andreas Mund and Fabian Koscher. And what we do here is that we look at a tissue, so this could be FFPE archived material. So these, there are about a billion of these samples worldwide and growing rapidly. And then we can do all the latest and greatest in imaging, high competence imaging. And we will use artificial intelligence to segment the cells and to classify the cells into different classes. And then we have a collaboration with Leica, where we then can use the contours from the AI that it's identified to cut out this, the cells that we're interested in, and then go through the pipeline that I just showed you, and also the clinical knowledge graph, and hopefully can give recommendations for clinicians or you know, find some new things. So this is several teams. So this is Peter Horwath's lab in Hungary. They are leaders in this AI and segmentation. And then Leica, so they made hardware modifications to their lab and our lab. So this is a hackathon in Copenhagen here. And it involves our two groups, both in Copenhagen and in Munich. So then we have a history in tissue proteomics. So for instance, in ovarian cancer here, also from Sophia again here. But until recently, we've always cut out areas of the cell or of the tissue, like here tumor area in ovarian cancer and the stromal region. This is also very interesting. So this led to the finding a target in the stroma, which is good because this cannot mutate. But the real prize would be to do single cells or single cell types. And this gives you an example of a pathology slide. So this salivary gland, so you can see the incredible richness of what again would otherwise just go into this blender and all be blended together. But now this is the software from the Horwath group, Peter Horwath group, that actually that segments, finds the outlines of the cells and classifies the cells into different classes based on their morphology, for instance, or antibody staining. And then we can say, you know, give me 99 cells of this type or 99 cells of that type, or you yourself come up with the five most distinct classes in this slide that I'm seeing. So this is an example here. Again, there's a close-up of what I showed you before. And now we've asked it to find five classes, and it did. So you can see some morphological differences, and this is what it had to go by. So then now we don't know, is this just looking different, or is it maybe also biologically different? And for this, we cut this out, and this will be video, but I'm skipping this. And you can cut out just single cells or like 100 of each kind, but you can also cut out quite a number in one day now, because like I made this quite fast. So, and this is an example, so this melanoma. And then we've classified here the cells, so they become colored. And then we have now measured the melanoma proteins. And then if you look in the what we identify, we see that all the most abundant proteins here, they actually have already been associated with melanoma. So this is called biological enrichment. So by focusing on the few percent of cells that are interesting to us, we actually make our analytical work much easier, because then our proteins of interest will be the most abundant ones often. So we don't need to stop at single cells. We can also excise nuclei, for instance, which we've done in this example here of cell culture. And then indeed the classes by image analysis, they also correspond to different classes according to their proteome. And then we can see what might be the functions of these classes, and this wouldn't be apparent from the picture. But once you do the proteomics, it became apparent that this is a migratory cell type, and we even found some new proteins there. And basically you can, like anything that you can see on an image, you could also try to cut it out and see what proteins are involved, like what are these processes between the cells. Maybe they communicate somehow mechanically, or they transfer something, so we don't know, but we could try to know by knowing what proteins are in there. And now, so this is all made available to Digimed, and we've already also using this here, not a single cell, but we're looking at plugs here, where we've taught the AI to, so this was a test case, 100 about, we could still do this by hand, but if you have but if you have 2,000, that gets boring and imprecise. So now actually the AI does it, and we're in the process of measuring this. And this is also the AI giving us the function or the annotation of the different regions after being taught by the pathologist. So this was what I wanted to say, and I want to thank Digimed Bayern very much. It's a very challenging and fun collaboration. And I want to thank my people in the two locations, and these people are particularly involved in Digimed Bayern. So thank you for your attention.
Well, I would like to thank you for this wonderful overview, but also this deep insight. It's almost incredible what you told us. And I have one question. When do you see, you already showed that you have a collaboration with a hospital, with Professor Teubzer, but when do you see a chance that proteomic technologies overcome the other omics, DNA omics, the transcriptomics technologies, and that proteomics, might it become the favorite instrument or tool for diagnosis in the hospitals, or is the technology that used, well, you use these big machines, or will that still take 10 or 20 years?
That's a very good and dangerous question. I also think I'm of the opinion that in many ways we build on top of the genetics, of course, right? Like we can never replace, or we don't even want to replace the genetics, but I would say the genetics only gets you so far, and looking at the proteins that gets you to the function, right? And so as far as in the clinic, it's a lot of regulatory problems that we have to overcome. Mm-hmm. I think, as I showed you in the liver, the technology is really starting to get there. In the US, there's actually a lot of startup funding, like in California, there's hundreds of millions are now being invested. That's also a bit of a problem in Germany, that there's not so much investment, but I think it will now come. And so plasma measurements can be done fast. You'll hear this from Sophia Doll also. And tissue measurements are getting there now, definitely.
Yeah. Well, I think that was coming up to my mind when I heard your talk. I said, well, if this would be done in the United States, people would run you over with all the tens of millions or hundreds of millions that they would like to invest in this technology. Unfortunately, that's not the case. But let's think about that. There was one question coming from a raised hand from Carsten Mahr. So, Carsten, if you could ask your question.
Hi there. You hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Great. Hi, both of you. Thanks, Matthias, for the amazing talk. I was wondering, how much difference do you expect in the proteome of a living live cell that you cut completely, as opposed to a cell where you cut a 3-micron slice from a histopathological section?
Yeah, but that's a very good question. So, so of course there's the 3D aspect to it, right? Like, so what I showed you, you look from the top and then you think you cut it out. But indeed in the tissue context, you will always either cut the cell in half or you will cut out maybe something from the cell below. So for instance, we've done experiments where we just cut out the nucleus, but then we still see some cytosolic proteins because there's cytosol above and below. Fortunately, the proteomics is very quantitative. So if we cut out, with the 3D structure, we know from microscopy where it is, and then we can cut out with that in mind. So we can take more or less of the inevitable contamination. And then depending on how the proteins go up and down, we can actually figure out what belonged to the structure that we were targeting and what didn't belong to the structure we were targeting. So for instance, if we just wanted the cell membrane, right, like then we could cut it out a little bit further or a little bit further inside, and then we would have the plasma membrane enriched.
Okay, thank you. I would now also like to open, let's say, the